Welcome back to the longest journey. I'm your host, Lost Wolf, and when last we left, we were about to talk to the cup stealer. This is episode 17, so here we go. Let's talk to him.
How about a game of cups today?
Sounds good. Okay, what can I win? How do I play? Okay, let's go. Sorry, but I'm broke. Thanks, but no thanks.
What can I win?
Well, there's coin, of course. Double your bet or choose from a wide variety of exotic prizes. Like this antique Domari canter from Guienne. A superb replica of Mount Tyrannae, cast in pure solid iron. A magic walnut from the once glorious island kingdom of Anciel. And this, unique bird.
Get me out of here!
Keep your beak shut, you scraggly piece of... And he talks! Great for feasts and for the amusement of infants. He's our top prize, a real keeper.
Okay,
how do I play?
You put your coin down on the table. I put a cup on top of it and shuffled it around with the other two cups. And all you have to do is guess which one hides your coin. And remember, no magic used and none allowed. This amulet right here will light up if you use magic. Then you'll be banned. For life!
Okay, let's go. Sorry, but I'm broke. Okay, right. Thanks, but no thanks.
Okay, let's go.
Just place your bet, investment, on the table and the game will begin.
Now, the thing about this is, had we not actually been nice to the lady, we would not have had spare coin, but oh well. Let's put a coin on the table.
Here's my coin. Now, how do I play?
I place one cup on top of your coin, like so. Then, I shuffle them, like so. Now, you guess which cup hides your coin. If you get it right, you win another coin. Three in a row, and you win a prize.
Okay, so not surprisingly, it's impossible for you to decide which cup he hid it under because they didn't do this close up. So what you need to do is you need to take the screwdriver over here and you need to tap it against the tops of each one.
Nothing happened. Hey, that cup moved.
And that
Nothing
must
happened.
Mean that... Your cup
it's
is this
one,
this one.
For sure.
That's correct, but that's... You used magic, didn't you? You used your magic wand.
Nah, your amulet didn't light up, did it?
No, but it's impossible.
Because you use magic yourself? Because nobody's supposed to ever win your game? They have a name for people like you, sir. Con artist.
There you go.
What? I'm outraged! I'm outraged!
Whatever. I want my prize.
Prize? You don't get a prize for winning once. Especially when you're cheating, you cheat.
You want me to call the city guard? I demand a prize.
Oh, by the gods of gambling. Here, take this and leave me be.
A calculator? Where did you get this?
Oh, I don't know. Won it off some guy who got it from someone else who's supposedly been in stock. It's a worth... I mean, it's a valuable souvenir from the mysterious and elusive world of logic. Now, would you please let me be? Let someone else play. Yes?
Okay, so we've got the calculator, and the calculator's kind of useful for where we're going. Now, we need to go to the enclave. An enclave is basically a place that we've heard about, but we haven't been to. The enclave. Uh, I notice there's that symbol again that we saw at the beginning of the game. We will see this sort of motif repeated a couple of times over and over again.
The dragon's mouth is pointing straight down at the middle of the floor.
Okay, that's an obvious clue that we need to go down.
It's a circular hollow about 20 centimeters across and about 5 centimeters deep. It's a circular hollow about 20 centimeters across and about 5 centimeters deep. It's a circular hollow about...
I want you to walk over there. Oh, great.
It's a circular hollow about 20 centimeters across and about 5 centimeters deep.
Do I really have... I've got a map of the Northlands. I forget if I'm supposed to give that to.
It's a map of the Northlands. I'm supposed to deliver this to,
Tunlyak,
staying at the Journeyman Inn.
Okay. Alright. There's downstairs. And, there's this guy over here.
It's one of the Sentinel Minster.
And we need to talk to him. May not be the guy we're looking for. I believe it might be the guy we're looking for, but I'm not sure. Yeah, it's the guy we're looking for because we can't go anywhere else. There are some stairs, though, and we can probably go down those.
Oh, goodness me, I didn't hear you come in. By the way, you haven't seen Volume 6 of the Complete Annotated History of the Northlands, have you? I could have sworn it was here yesterday.
Sorry, no.
I guess someone else must have taken it. I try to tell them to write down what they borrow on the list, but they never listen. Only last week, I spent 3 hours searching the entire enclave for the second scripture of the ballads, the scripture of song, before I realized that Vestrum Tobias was studying it back in the city. Now, such incidents could be avoided if only... And this applies to you too, young lady. People would sign out the books they borrow when they borrow them and sign them back in when they're done. Such a simple procedure. It shouldn't take more than a few seconds to jot down your name and the name of the book you borrow. It makes my job so much easier. Now, which book did you want me to find for you?
Are you Minstrom Yaren? And I'll see you later.
Are you Minstrom Yaren?
Yes, of course. What a silly question.
How would I know? I don't know you.
I am Minstrom Yaren, keeper of the Great Library of Mercuria. In fact, this is the greatest library of all the Northlands. Perhaps of the entire world. Although they say the Dark People have a library as big, if not bigger, than this one. But of course, we're not allowed anywhere near there. Have you been there?
I don't think...
What a silly question. Of course you haven't. You're not of the Dark People, are you? You don't look like any Dark People I've ever seen, so I can't see how you could possibly... Now, where did Volume 6 disappear to,
Tobias said I should talk with you.
Tobias said I should talk with you.
Tobias? Vestrum Tobias? I haven't seen him for... Well, he was in last week, but before that it must have been... days, at least. How is he? Still eating enough for 2 mules? I must tell you of this funny story I heard the other day. Of how Vestrum Tobias eats enough for a table full of Minstrom. Or was it one Elguan? Although the Elguan don't, as a rule, eat very much at all. Did you know that the Elguan can smell water more than half a day's journey away? Amazing, amazing creatures, perfectly suited for a life in the desert. The balance provides, that's for certain. The balance provides.
Vestrum Tobias recommended that I look at some books. We're awfully close to this guy, though.
Vestry Tobias recommended that I look at some books.
Books is what we do best here at the Enclave. That is for certain. Which book would you like to see?
I'm looking for some information, but I'm not sure what book to ask for. I'm looking for a story called The Silver Spear. Goramon. A book on the history of Mercuria would be interesting. I'd like to read some Arcadian folk tales. Actually, I don't feel like reading right now. Let's start at the top and work our way down.
I'm looking for some information, but I'm not sure which book to ask for.
No matter. I know a great deal about most of the books in here. What topic intrigues you?
I've heard rumors about mermen who live beneath the sea as songs. I'd like to find out more about them. Are there any books about flying people who observe and tell stories? I need to find out which four magical people are. Arcadia were given a piece of the stone disc that serves as the key to the Guardian's realm. I'd like to learn more about dragons, about the Draken. I forget, but thanks anyway. Let's start at the top right.
I've heard rumors about mermen who live beneath the Sea of Songs, and I'd like to find out more about them.
Mermen in the Sea of Songs? Let me see what I can find, yes?
And off he goes. This is going to be the reading episode where I read a lot of stuff to you. Because we need to learn about the world that we're in. I like this, but I don't know if this is everyone's cup of tea.
I did find something of interest. I'll leave it here for you to read.
Okay, so what we'll do is we'll go and peruse it. Mermen, also mermen, merpeople, and merians, or merim, sorry, are magical people who reside in the depths of the great ocean and the other seas. Little contact has been made with the mermen, who are believed to have been quite numerous in the past, but are now dwindling in numbers. Confirmed location of merim cities is between the Bristan Atoll and Gien, entering the Sea of Songs. Legends of the mermen, merpeople, merians, are rampant amongst sailors. These stories portray the merim in a grotesque and violent light, betraying the truth of a largely peaceful people. Although not much is known about the merim, their religion apparently centers around the belief of a benevolent god who lives in the immense depths of the great ocean and who brought the merim to earth from a place distant and wonderful. Okay, and of course, once we're done, we just exit.
Are you done? Let me take that back for you.
Thank you. You're very kind. I find it interesting that the accounts of the sailors and the accounts of the book differ, but, I mean, that's kind of to be expected. Okay, so let's talk to them some more.
Oh, goodness, it's you again. Oh, you gave me such a fright.
Could I see some
Could
more books?
See some more books?
Oh, certainly. What a silly question.
I'm looking for some information, but I'm not sure which book to ask for.
No matter. I know a great deal about most of the books in here. What topic intrigues you?
Okay, are there any books about the flying people? I should actually write down what we read.
Because
I'm going to forget, I'm sure.
Winged storytellers, let me see what I can find. Hold on.
I need to find a piece of paper. Well, I need to find a section of my... We've asked about the merman. So that's done.
I did find something of interest. I'll leave it here for you to read.
Thank you. And off we go. Alatian.
The island of Elias, near the Bristan Atoll. Maybe I should try to go there.
A crafty winged people who have recently dwindled in numbers and whose ability to fly long distances has been steadily diminishing over the past three centuries. The Latian are known for their ability to remember and tell stories from before the dawn of mankind and up to modern events. The largest known tribe of Latian, with whom traders have occasional contact, resides in the otherwise uninhabited island of Alais in the Bristol Great Hall.
Are you done? Let me take that back for you.
Thank you. I am going to skip his animations, just so we can move this along a bit. Okay, I want to see more books. I'm looking for some matter. Latian. Those are the winged people, I must not forget. I need to find out which four magical people of Arcadia were given a piece of the stone disc.
I need to find out which four magical people of Arcadia were given a piece of the stone disc that serves as the key to the Guardian's realm.
The stone disc of the balance, yes? Yes, there could possibly be something on that in... let me check. Just one moment.
And off he goes.
I did find something of it.
Thank you. Chapter 16 in the 8th scripture, the scripture of breaking. Regarding the disc of the balance, and the events that came about when the disc was broken, the scriptures tell us that the disc was kept at the enclave for many thousands of years, safely guarded from any threat by the respect held by every man and woman for the authority of the fathers. But with dissent came disobedience. Disobedience brought immorality, and immorality brought theft, begat theft. Tyrant soldiers, aided by the sentinel traders, attempted to make away with the disc, but were thwarted by the white of the kin herself, intervening. Although forbidden to do so on behalf of the fathers, the disc was brought safely back to the enclave, but the threat would linger in the minds of the Minstrom and the Vestrom. So it became that the disc was melted in the forge of the dragon's mouth, shaped into the element of fear of all magical people, and given to these respective people for safekeeping, until such a time when it was decreed that the disc should once more be whole. One stone to the gentle souls that sing in the dark and shape the earth between their toes. One stone to the watchers of the woods, the ones who are outside. One stone to the two that make one of air and sea. And one stone to the keepers of the dark flame, the eternally dark, the mariners. When the time comes for the disc to be whole again, one person will make a journey to the four who hold the pieces, and the pieces will be given willingly, because there will be no doubt the righteousness of this person. Okay.
Are you done? Let me take that back.
Right. Let's ask him some more things.
Oh, goodness. It's you again. You gave me such a fright.
Could I see some more books?
Oh, certainly.
I'm looking for some information.
No matter.
I'd like to learn more about dragons, about the dragkin.
I'd like to learn more about dragons, about the dragkin.
Oh, yes, yes. We have some wonderful books on that topic. Stay here.
Interestingly enough, also, he goes further and further away.
I did find something of interest.
Secrets of the Dragkin by Minstrom Eliak. The Dragkin are known by many names throughout the Twin Worlds. In Old Tongue, they are often referred to as Dragkin. In some variations of Low Tongue, Drachen. In the Southlands, the word Dreich refers specifically to the winged lizard shape, typically traditionally associated with a kin. In Erhad, the eternal spirit of the kin are called simply Drak, regardless of their current shape. In Stark, most cultures refer to the kin as dragon, Drage, Drach, Dragon. Though this usually refers only to the winged lizard-like shape, and not to the spirit inhabiting the shape, in fact. While in Arcady, the kin are respected and revered as eternal spirits with great significance in the balance and the all. In Stark, the kin are mostly creatures of mythology and fairy tales. However, in some Stark legends and scriptures, notably the Christian Bible, the name Dragon is associated with the forces of evil, and thus the religious connections do seem to have carried over in a somewhat distorted form. Who or what are the Draken? Why not ask who is the creator, or what is the all? Questions thus asked will remain, in perpetuity unanswered, for they are in truth unanswerable. To condense all knowledge of the creator into one answer is futile, as is any attempt to define the all, without describing every single element that makes up the all. So also with the dry kin, we cannot answer who is the kin or what is the kin, but we can provide some answers to the simpler questions, the questions that deal with what we see and hear and feel, and what we have been told by the kin themselves. Answers that, together, may give us, if only the faintest hint of the whole truth, then at least some indication of who or what the Draken are. Born of the emptiness between the stars, reads the 11th scripture of the balance, the scripture of time, shaped in unison with the all, part of the all, yet outside the all. Draken, note the ancient high tongue, variation of Draken. Why so many variations, interpretations of the Draken from culture to culture? The kin have always been shrouded in mystery, and from mystery rises legend and myth. The kin seem content to be seen as nothing but tall tales and figments of a bard's fertile imagination.
Are you done?
Yes.
Let me take that back for you.
Thank you. Alright, let's get ourselves another book. Now, this is the point where we get into the kind of other stuff, the more meaty stuff. This other stuff that we're doing now is kind of by the way.
You gave me such a fright.
Sure.
Can I see some more books?
Oh, certainly. What is...
Okay, so...
I'm looking for some information, but...
No matter.
We have read all this. And, if we say I'd like to read more, what
I'd
will happen...
I'd like to read more about the Draken.
Why, of course. I will get the book you're looking for immediately.
I just want to quickly do this, just so you can see what happens.
I did find some.
If you ask him for the same book, or if you ask him for more, most notably, you get the same book again, so there's no actual point in reading this. So we're going to bail out of that. Yeah, thanks. And we're going to go to our other stuff, the stuff that we had on the top of our list to ask about.
It's you again. You gave me such a...
Could I see some more books?
I'm looking for a story called The Silver Spear of Goryeon.
I'm looking for a story called The Silver Spear of Goryeon.
Yes, a fanciful tale if I ever saw one, but a charming one. Did you know that I'm often paid visit by adventurers wishing to read everything available on the spear, so that they too could set out on their foolish quests?
Yeah, don't you just hate those adventurers?
Well, they pay for my bread, milk, and butter with their contributions to the coffers, so I shouldn't be too critical of them. But they care not about the books. They care only about what the books can give them.
I care. About the books, really?
Really?
I can tell. So, the Silver Spear of Goryeon, then?
And off he goes to find it.
I did find something of interest. I'll leave it here for you to read.
All right. The silver spear of Goramon. In the glory days of Bakshira, before the drought, when Goramon was the greatest city in the known world, the Parak of Bakshira decided to forge the most powerful weapon in the world to challenge the mighty white dragon. The Parak had grown greedy and bored, his treasure hold filled with the riches of the world, and he desired nothing except the one thing he could never have, the unborn daughter of the white dragon, the fairest, purest, most beautiful creature in the universe. He had asked the white dragon for her daughter's hand in marriage, but she had refused, scolding him for his insolence and warning him to keep his distance from immortals. And so the Parak sought dead by a silver mighty sorcerer, the dark and cruel Eos, to learn how to kill one of the Draken. The sorcerer told the Parak of the white silver of Mount Tourney, the strongest substance in Arcadia, and how it could be forged by magic to kill even one of the Ken. The Parak ordered his army to go north across the ocean and to bring back enough white silver to shape a weapon. When his men returned with the rare metal, the Parak ordered the finest blacksmith in Bathsheba to his castle, where Eos the sorcerer cast a spell to create an unholy forge. 10 days and 10 nights it took before the exhausted blacksmith could present a tall spear to his emperor. But before the spear could be used to kill one of the kin, it had to be bathed in blood. Beheading the poor blacksmith and the soldiers who had retrieved the white silver from Mount Tourney, the Parak's private bath was filled with their blood. As he dropped the silver spear into the red bath, watched over by Eos, a terrible scream erupted, and steam rose up in a red, foul-smelling cloud. When the steam lifted, the blood was all gone, and the spear was glowing in a deep red color. With a terrible weapon now ready to be wielded, the Parak issued a challenge to the white dragon, to either surrender her daughter to him for marriage, or to suffer a painful death at his hand. Enraged, the white dragon refused him yet again, and flew to meet the Parak. His sorcerer and his 1,000-strong army in the green fields outside Goramon. Of the magical silver spear she knew nothing, and the Parak kept it wrapped in cloth by his side. "Bring your forces around, Parak," warned the white dragon. "If you do not, I will lay waste to them all." "I wish my men no harm," lied the Parak, "for this is between the two of us." He then rode forward alone and dismounted his horse, but stayed within reach of the spear. The white dragon landed before him, and she said, "You are brave to face me like this when you know you cannot harm me." Then the Parak raised a hand as if to greet her, but it was instead assigned to his sorcerer, the terrible Eos, who cast a mighty spell to hold the white dragon while the Parak drew the silver spear. The white dragon fought bravely, and she was close to escaping the sorcerer's magic, but the Parak was quick, and he thrust his magic spear into her chest. She screamed in pain and anger, and the sorcerer's spell could no longer hold her. Rising on her beautiful wings, blood pouring down to the land below, the cursed Bathsheba, her Parak, and her people for all time. Sorry, she cursed them. Wherever the white dragon's blood fell, the land turned arid, and grass became sand. The Parak sent his army to follow the white dragon and to bring back her egg, but the drought grew, and within days, the once proud empire of Bathsheba was turning into a desert. Then followed a fierce storm that tore across the land for 100 days and nights, and when the dust settled, there was nothing left of Bathsheba but 2 coastal cities and a few scattered oases. It is said that in the buried ruins of a lost capital, wrapped in the arms of the Parak who dared test the immortal rests the silver spear of Goramon. And with that, we're going to end off today. Tomorrow we'll pick up from where we left off, and we'll read some more. Thank you so much for joining me. I've been your host, Lost Wolf. This has been episode 17 of My Friend of the Longest Journey. And I shall see you all tomorrow night when we continue. Thank you so much for watching, folks.